Hey, Grant, thank you so much for having us on your farm.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's a pleasure. So, having you here.
Can you please tell us something about your farm, like what you do here, like what you produce?
Sure. Yep. So, I'm Grant Estrade with Local Cooling Farms and Laughing Buddha Nursery. We're at Local Cooling Farms right now in Bogalusa, and our operation here is we've got a livestock operation, so we raise goats, beef, pigs, and laying hens, and we sell all of that product direct to consumer through our retail store in Metairie, which is Laughing Buddha Nursery. But the other big thing that we do up here at Local Cooling Farms is composting. We've been in the composting business now for about 15 years. And so we do vermicomposting with red wiggler worms. And we also do more of a traditional composting where we sell the compost and soil blends like potting soil.
A lot of growers are very much excited to use the product from vermicompost. Can you explain the process of vermicomposting?
Sure. You know, with the vermicomposting, it just enhances the compost that much better. So the bag that we have here is the compost that we use in our blends. It's also the compost that we sell directly to the consumer for top dressing and amending their beds. But after we go through all the temperature cycles with our compost and we want to make worm castings, which is worm manure, then we add the red wigglers to this compost. They break it down even further, creating a more concentrate, more biologically diverse compost.
So you saying that this is actually, you know, like at the back for where you are preparing for your worm casting?
That's right. That's right.
Awesome. And you just mentioned that these are already finished compost.
That's right. Yep.
So, like, which process did you use to prepare this compost?
So we're, you know, the feedstocks that we take in are coffee grounds. So we take those coffee grounds in, we add in hardwood mulch to the process, and then we mix it. And then we let it go through all this temperature fluctuation. Sometimes it takes several weeks for us to get to that point. On an average of, say, 4 weeks, we have a finished compost product if we turn it accordingly. And then we, you know, temperature is a big thing that we do to gauge whether or not the compost is done or not. And then before we add the worms in here, though, we make sure that the compost is stable temperature-wise, because if the temperature is still too hot, if it spikes for some reason, the worms are not going to be happy and they're going to end up dying in there.
I saw that you have a nice thermometer over here. Can you show us how you measure the temperature?
That's right. So after when these bags have 1 cubic yard in them, and so after we place the compost in there, we do end up throwing into another heat cycle, and we may go into the 85-90 degree realm when we do that. So we want to make sure that we test the temperature to make sure that we've got a good low temperature, happy for the worms. And typically after we fill these bags, we wait about 1 month for everything to stabilize. Mm-hmm. It's probably a little bit longer than we need to, but we just want to make sure that that nothing's going to happen to the worms. So we let them sit for about a month before we put the red wigglers in there. And right now we're at 65.2 degrees. Mm-hmm. And so that's looking good. So it's totally safe to put the worms in right now.
Awesome. So what is the normal temperature cycle after you put it here? Like how high it goes normally?
Oh, so even after we've gone through our initial heat cycles and then we put it in the sack, because we put 4 big scoops in the sack to get the cubic yard. So it's, you know, it gets aerated pretty good. It'll spike back up into the 90s very easily. So it doesn't really pass the 90s too much, but that's still way too hot for the red wigglers to put them in there.
Awesome. That's fantastic. Thank you for explaining that.
Yep.
So how much compost do you normally put in this bag, like in one batch?
One bag, we put 1 cubic yard in.
Okay. Is there any important part about the height or amount of materials that you put it in the bag?
Yeah, so the red wigglers are surface dwelling worms, so they do want to hang out in areas where they're going to get airflow. And so obviously they're going to hang out at the top. But our concern is we want to make sure that the worms are going to go down further in the bed, because we want them to get to the compost to be able to break it down into the worm castings. And so so typically we have the 1 cubic yard in here is about 24 inches tall. The bottom 8 inches at the very bottom of the sack, you know, not a lot of worm activity there, but we need that layer in air to help retain moisture in the bed. Mm-hmm. And so, but out of the 24 inches, we've got about 16 inches of the bed that's pretty active with the worms.
Awesome. I saw some label in your bag. Can you please explain this again? Here.
That's right. So the bag is 24 inches tall. So on average, the bag is about 4 foot by 4 foot wide. So it's about 16 square feet, 24 inches tall. This bottom 8 inches here, we don't get a lot of activity here with the worms just because that's going to be our most anaerobic area at the bottom where all that weight is pressing down. So we're not really counting on worms being active in this area. We're counting on them being very active in this area. So when we go to screen, we make sure that for the most part, we're stopping about right here when we pull that material out.
So what will you do with those materials?
That bottom material will go right back into the composting cycle. And so we'll use that material in another batch.
That's good. I saw that you have a pallet over here, you know, like a... Is there any important things to consider?
So important. First off is for material handling. We have the Bobcat here with the fork. So anything that we can put on a skid or a pallet to be able to move it around the farm, it's great for material handling. It's also giving us some aeration here at the bottom and proper drainage. Drainage is probably the number one thing because we leave these bags out in the shade and they get full rainfall. And so during times of high rainfall, keeping this bag off the pallet, it'll drain properly. And that way we keep a pretty even moisture content in the bag.
That's wonderful. Thank you. So you said like this bag is like ready for...
So right now we've put the 1 cubic yard of compost in about a month ago, and we've checked the temperature. And so we're ready to actually put some red wigglers in there.
Okay.
So right now what Will is doing, he's screening the batch that has had worms in it for about 4 months. It takes about 4 months for the red wigglers to go through the bedding in order to ensure that we get a quality worm casting out of it. The screen that we're using is a 1/4 inch minus, and that's going to ensure that we've got baby worms and the eggs coming out through into the castings, and that's going to help create a better quality casting. All right, so what we're doing now is that this is all the overs. So this is all the big particles coming out, but more importantly, all the adult worms are coming out of this end as well. So you can see those are the red wigglers right there, which is mostly adults.
Yeah, those are very small ones also.
That's right, they're a smaller worm. They're much smaller than your European night crawlers.
Some looks like pregnant, is that pregnant one?
That's right, that's a good sign that they're gonna put out a cocoon real soon.
Okay, so when you mix these worms in a new, worm casting pile, how long it will take this small baby worm to become adult?
Usually the life cycle from cocoon to maturity is going to be several months before they're able to do that. So the worms that we put in, if they lay in a cocoon today, the baby worm is going to have an opportunity to become fully mature in these piles before we put a screen on it.
Awesome. Can you like a guess that I just want a rough guess, you know, like with a handful of this material in your hand, how many worms probably will be here?
Well, let's say for instance, if it was 1 pound of worms, which is about 1,000 worms. If we put 1,000 worms in the bag in about 4 months, that may very well create about 3 pounds of adult worms, which is going to be several thousand adult worms. But more importantly, it's going to be thousands and thousands and thousands of baby worms. It could be upwards to 10 to 20,000 baby worms in this pile at the end of the 4 month cycle.
Fantastic. So you are going to mix this, this product to your worm casting bag?
That's right. That's right. And so we'll put in quite a bit of this material into the worm bed. And then these worms are going to leave this material and they're going to go straight into the main bedding. And then we'll put about 40 gallons or so of this material and top this area off to ensure that we've got enough worms in the bin.
40 gallons means probably like 6 inches, 4 to 6 inches.
That's right, yeah, that's right, yep, okay. Yep.
And these worms will go down.
They'll go down, yep, yeah. And then the cool thing is that all these overs that we pulled out, and these overs are all the hardwood mulch that we put in at the beginning of the composting process. These overs will serve as a top mulch layer to help retain moisture into the bed.
That is fantastic.
That's why we like to do the average 6 inches. You know, 4 to 6 inches of this material, mm-hmm. just like you'd mulch a vegetable garden, 4 to 6 inches. That's what we like to see.
So again, you know, like after you put the toppings with this worm, and then it will go through like five month cycle.
That's right. And then we'll be here again, screening it right back through, and then retrieving the worms out and putting them back into the bins. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing is that we do supply folks with red wiggler worms themselves. Mm-hmm. So if we don't pull them out to put into the bed, we'll actually pull them out and sell them to folks for their own home worm bins.
Okay, so you sell it like this, like that product, or you screen or separate the worms?
We actually use a different bedding to raise the worms in.
Oh, you raise the worms separately.
That's right. So we have this is more of a vermicomposting system here, mm-hmm. and we have more of a vermiculture system. We do it the same way, mm-hmm. but we use a finer material than this compost to do that. So this is a picture of the finished product. Mm-hmm. So this is, you know, where it started, and then this is the product that we're actually going to mm-hmm. sell.
I can still see some of the small worms. So is it good for the compost?
That's
because
right.
Many growers like to have some worms in there.
That's right. We may not sell these castings right away.
Okay.
So they may be weeks or a month before we actually sell the castings. Mm-hmm. And so there may be a little material in here that the worms can still finish composting. Mm-hmm. So for the quality of our casting, we really like to leave these baby worms in there. Mm-hmm. And that way, that just helps out the product mm-hmm. get a little bit better. And I'm going to peel some of this back. This is a baby worm right here mm-hmm. that's going to end up being sold in the castings that we sell. Mm-hmm. And then there it is.
Okay.
That is a worm cocoon right there, which may have 1 to 3 baby worms that will hatch out of it. Mm-hmm. So that's what we want to see. We want to see castings with little baby worms in it and also some eggs. And in that way, we feel like the customers are going to get a real high quality casting product.
Awesome. So this is your final casting.
This is our final.
You don't mix anything.
That's right.
Supplement.
That's right. This is our final product. And now what we do with this is that this will also go into the potting soils mm-hmm. as well as our raised bed mix that we sell. So then we'll get this, sell it, but we'll also use it as an ingredient mm-hmm. Into our final products. But interestingly enough, when we mix the compost mm-hmm. in the very beginning, we put worm castings in it. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, we don't know all the organisms that are in soil, mm-hmm. But the reason that we do that is because we're going to assume there's beneficial microbes in the castings, mm-hmm. so we want to put that in at the beginning of all of our composting cycles. So we'll use this as a biological inoculant as well.
That's great. Okay, one question. Since you have been doing this worm casting from last several years, what did you change from the one that you were doing at first and going on till now? Did you make any changes as you...
Yeah, we did. Equipment and location has changed as well as the feedstocks.
Okay.
You know, which is one thing, if you're composting, you always want to remain, on your toes as far as what feedstocks may be coming in, because mm-hmm. if you set your process up to not be able to be adaptable, mm-hmm. you may lose a feedstock source, or it may change, and you may mm-hmm. have to be able to adopt for that. So one day you may be getting coffee grounds, the other day you may be getting horse stable sweepings, and you need to be able to adapt with that. Mm-hmm. But over the years, what we've tried to do is reduce our hand labor and be able to use the equipment to do all the heavy lifting. Mm-hmm. Before, we were doing much smaller beds by hand, mm-hmm. And now, you know, we rely upon the Bobcat to move this unit around. Mm-hmm. And so for the most part, many things have changed. The process has stayed the same. Mm-hmm. The major thing has changed has been our material handling.
Okay, so you are just sticking it into one material, or you use different feedstock?
Say that again?
So you are only using one type of feedstock, or you are producing worm casting with different feedstock?
That's right. So right now we've got enough feedstock of coffee grounds to be able to do all of our worms in right now. Mm-hmm. And so right now we've got that consistent supply of coffee grounds. Mm-hmm. We've got the consistent supply of the hardwood mulch. Mm-hmm. So right now we've got a very nice stable supply. And that's so we have that recipe that we're using.
Okay. Based on your experience, what is the best feedstock for worm casting? Like, what do worms really like?
You know, they'll eat so many different things. The key with the worms is to pre-compost any of the material that you're getting in. So if you're getting in produce scraps, vegetable scraps, if you're getting coffee grounds in, or if you're getting kind of manure, the key is pre-composting it. That's going to stabilize the material, and that's what the worms really do like. But for the most part, the worms are pretty pretty adaptable. I mean, you can feed them cellulose or lignin-based stuff, like even shredded cardboard that's been broken down, to the coffee grounds, to vegetable scraps. So they're very adaptable.
That's a really important point, like pre-composting. You know, like with the pre-composting, you are, you know, like maintaining the temperature, you know, as well as minimizing any food safety risk associated with that compost.
That's right, especially if you're using any animal manures, because this is not a thermal composting process. Ideally, with those feedstocks, you'll go through a thermal composting process. That's going to get rid of any potential pathogen activity in it. And so that compost that you're feeding to the worms has already been pathogen free. And then now you're dealing with a real stable product.
So are there like a growers using non-composted material for worm casting? They do.
You can do that.
Okay.
You'd have to manage how much you're putting down at one time so the worm bin doesn't get hot. Because if you're constantly adding stuff that's breaking down, your heat may spike in your worm bed, and then you may end up just killing them, or they may end up vacating the bin altogether. They won't do well. So they don't like the heat, so you really need to avoid that heat spike.
That's a really fantastic, good point. You know, like using the pre-composting material, you are actually providing really nice environment for the worms.
That's right. You're giving a nice stable pH, stable moisture, you know, a consistent particle supply, particle size, and they just do so much better that way.
Okay. Do you have to change like the moisture, like after you produce the compost? Do you need to change moisture for worm casting, or the moisture content after? Like the composting is fine.
The worms are going to like it a little bit on the higher moisture side. And so we'll leave these bags open so we get normal rainfall.
Okay.
But we will have to constantly check them to make sure, because we will water them if the rainfall isn't doing enough. So they like a nice, you know, if you squeeze it and a little water comes out, that's about where the worms do like it.
Like 55 to 65% moisture.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. That's good.